been the damn IRS until July. Once the Internal Revenue Service has returned to us every penny plus interest, we demand the permanent abolishment of the damn Internal Revenue Service. Then we're going to sue the corporations, the corporate employers, for theft for your damn W-4 forms, which are wage levies. You understand? This is how free man thinks. But you people don't have no backbone. See, I've learned that the real government is in the county. See, in the Republic, where all of our rights are intact, our highest elected official is what? The county sheriff, the county sheriff. We will restore lawful government, right? You gotta first start with the counties. The general provost marshal, duty, calls like never before. Start taking names, folks. Let the innocent people out of prison. Why do you have the innocent people in prison? The Lord's going to open those prison doors and let them out. That's what's going on right now. And you can't do a damn thing about it. It's God's work. It's your house work. Many of them are going home. All of their property should be restored to them. All of the innocent people, plus you holding them there when they was innocent. Let them be reparated. And let those reparations come from your pockets. And Mr. Bar attorneys, we're going to return back to prison all the real criminals. All the real criminals that's routinely set loose into our communities, like the pedophiles, these treasonous authorities that practice pedophilia at Bohemian Grove. Many of you bar attorneys, you join in the crimes with them. You know what's going on. Municipal traffic court judges, right? Bankruptcy court, probate court, federal court. It makes no damn difference. You are the most hideous people on the face of this earth. We've awakened, man, to the real state of affairs that we live in, this matrix, this damn bizarre world that's called the matrix. And knowing thus, it should come as no surprise that the man in the black robe, right, supposedly learned in the law, is in reality a damn extortionist, a career criminal. The most unlawful creature on this earth. Because if he was truly enforcing the damn law, most of our brothers and sisters, unless it's a violent crime, wouldn't be locked up. The judge's bank, which is, you call bench. In Latin, the damn bench is a bank. His bank is movable. It's a movable feat. His black robe highly appropriates for a bird of corrosion. So you're all in breach of the covenant, in breach of the trust, in breach of the contract. And so in your souls and in commerce, you're in dishonor. Because you know damn well in your souls that what you're doing is wrong. And you're going to have to answer for it. If not in this room, you're damn sure going to have to enter it in the next room. You're going to have to enter. You will enter for it. You know what you're doing is wrong. Your rights are forfeited. Your property is forfeited. Trust or no trust. We the people or the living souls. We're the light of the world, taking responsibility. We're going to create a different venue in accordance with the Declaration of Independence. It's some to abolish the gift of service. Even as you listen right now, the Lord is phasing many of you out. You cannot turn back from this. Come into the light, you members of the bar, come into the light. Admit that you are attached to a wicked, demonic system. Go into the light. You have a door plunge, you better come into the light. Better come into the light, man, because right now, you're facing hell on this planet. The coronavirus is not discriminating against any of you. Now, because they have us in a matrix, right? Neo, let me tell you a little something about the matrix. Let me show you how they got it set up, right? Neo is a protagonist, right? The protagonist initially goes by the name Thomas Anderson in public, right? In the public saw as a debtor, right? Thomas Anderson. The name Thomas was actually one of the disciples of Hamash Yahusha, right? And when you study scripture, people historically refer to him as Doubting Thomas. He was always unsure, Doubting Thomas. Anderson is the surname deriving from the protonic, meaning son of Anders or son of Andrews, right? That derived from the Greek word Andreas, meaning man. So when you put Anderson together, you get the son of man. When you put it together, the son of man is Christ. So we have first name, Doubting Thomas, who was the debtor, first part of his name, that was the unconscious you. When you were asleep, you was Doubting Thomas. You doubt everything that I say. Some of you, all the information that I just gave, many of you are still doubting it because you're like Thomas, but you're not like Anderson, like the son of man. You're like the first half of his name. You're the Doubting Thomas, right? You're Doubting Thomas because you're still unconscious and you're still asleep in the matrix, right? But when you become a secure party creditor, you assume that surname. Anderson, which is really the son of man, which is really Christ, which is really Neo, who's often referred to as the one, right? The one. So until the Lord sends one to wake you up, you become Christ-like. The one, a secure party creditor, is awoke and can discharge debts and not be affected by their color. Laws, statutes, codes. So Thomas, similarly, Nia, he often struggled with his belief system, just like you. Some of you don't know what to believe. You don't know whether, man, does this secure party creditor stuff work or not? See, you're Doubting Thomas. You're dead, right? This is how Thomas, who became Neo, was in the movie, right? See, first, as a lost man coming to the truth, when he was Doubting Thomas, then a saved man doubting his position. Thomas will later be called Neo when you watch the movie, right? Now, to strengthen the allegory, we will call this character Thomas until he takes the red pill. The red pill. So I wrote a book called Red Pill White Knowledge. You thought it was just a title. So after he takes the red pill, he becomes Neo. Now, the name Neo means new. The names of Thomas and Neo contrast the old and new condition. Scripture said to take off the old man and put on the new man. So the old man, Thomas, is the debtor. He becomes Neo, he becomes the creditor. The scripture says that when a sinful man comes to salvation, he is a new creature in Christ. What? The old things passed away. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Go and read it for yourself. Thomas is the old man. Neil is the new man. From debtor to secure party creditor. What? So when the FedEx man, when we go to the movie, what? When the FedEx man brings the package to Thomas, who becomes Neo, when he brings it to his cubicle, early in the film in Acts, Thomas Anderson, Thomas replies, "Call it. Yes, that's me." See, this acceptance of the debtor name, of the straw man name, this corporate fiction indicates his initial loss condition and blind mind, right? His immersion in blindness. Now, after Neo is saved from the Matrix, Agent Smith, he continues to call Neo Mr. Anderson, to which Neo replies with conviction, "My name is Neo," signifying his overstanding of his new self as the secure party creditor. So to parallel Satan's persistence, Agent Smith calls Neo Mr. Anderson 11 times in the first film, The Matrix. Neo, born as Thomas Anderson, also known as the one, what? He was known as the one, an anagram for Neo, the one. Neo is also an anagram of one, a reference to his destiny of being the one who would actually bring peace, just like the Messiah coming to bring peace after he brings that destruction. So Anderson literally means, again, folks, son of man, which is how Christ is primarily referred to in the scriptures. Now, in contrast, Morpheus, which is the representation of God the Father in the movie, right? Morpheus and crew always calls him Neo, reinforcing the truth of who he wants to be and who he indeed becomes after the redemption process, after he becomes a secure public creditor, after salvation. So we first see Thomas is sleeping. What? So it is apparently a nightmare. He's having a nightmare. Thomas is wearing black. The term sleep, my good brother Mikael, and darkness is always used to describe a lost person in the scriptures. He's in gross darkness. He's asleep. That is symbolic to a lost person, a debtor, a straw man, a corporate construct. He's dead to the truth. He's lost, right? We ought not, nor we are not of night, nor of darkness. So let us not sleep as do others. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 4 through 5. King James Version. So until he is saved by becoming a secure party creditor, Thomas is always literally asleep, like most of you debtors in the sound of my voice right now. In his womb-like pod. The pod was akin to him being in his mom's womb, asleep. Of this machine power plant, right? In the real world. See, this is actually striking portrayal of how a lost person, which is a debtor straw man, is spiritually asleep, even though he perceives himself to be awake. Most people that come at me and attack me, they think that they're awake, but they're asleep. The de facto has them asleep, right? So as Thomas sleeps, his computer is searching. This is the first indication of Thomas' discomfort with his life. He's searching, which is the key to finding the truth. John 8 and 32. And you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Matthew 7, verse 7. Seek, and you shall find. Trinity, which represents the Holy Spirit, the female in the movie. So now we got Morpheus, God the Father. We got Anderson, which is Christ, God the Son. And now we got Trinity, the woman, the Holy Spirit. So Trinity later confirms this searching when she tells Thomas, I know why you hardly sleep, why you live alone, and why the night after night you sit at your computer, you're looking. Thomas lives alone, which reflects his desire to separate from the fallen world. The media on Thomas' computer seems to portray Morpheus as a wanted criminal. This is how they portray us to try and free your mind. I'm trying to liberate your thinking. All of the people that the Most High has actually raised up to try and liberate your thinking, they refer to them as wanted criminals. John the Baptist, Jeremiah, the Apostle Paul. The list goes on and on. So just like Morpheus, by the media, is portrayed as a wanted criminal worldwide. When in truth, Morpheus is a good man who wants to save humanity because he represents God the Father. So that might be parallel to much of the blatantly anti-God, anti-Israelite media that's going on today. They said, Israelites, we're going to put a stop to it, Elijah said. So the computer screen clears and a message appears from Trinity, who comes from outside the Matrix woman. Trinity warns, wake up, Neo. The Matrix has you. And he wakes up. So I'm telling all of you in the sound of my voice that hasn't woken up, wake up. The Matrix has you with a COVID-19 virus. The Matrix has you with a stimulus plan. So the Trinity character may at times portray the Holy Spirit. According to Christianity, there's another version of God. God is paradoxically depicted in Scripture as a Trinity when you're dealing with Christianity. Now, they're not dealing with the truth, right? They're dealing with Christianity. So, yeah, God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit as Trinity. A single being. They say you get three out of one. Yet made up of three persons known as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So this scene parallels the Spirit of Yah, the Spirit of God convicting the lost persons of a dire condition. Wake up. Wake up, Neo. Sin in the fallen world has you. Book of Ephesians 5 and 14 puts it like this. Wake up, O sleeper. Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. So I'm telling all you debtors to wake up and let the Spirit shine on you. Become a secure party creditor. What are you waiting for? See, Thomas strangely awakens as if he somehow heard the message internally, which hits at the spiritual nature of the warning. Trinity does not live in the Matrix illusion. She came from outside it. And similarly, Hamas Yah, the one that you call Jesus Christ, said, I am not of this world. Look at John 17, verse 15. The scripture states clearly that Christ was not just a real man. He was God come to earth as man in Colossians 2 and 9, in Philippians 2, 5 through 11, in John 1, 1 through 14. So just as Trinity Bond and Thomas, man-made computer, were a message written by someone from the outside world, the scriptures also claim to be supernaturally inspired message from the Most High himself to mankind as human writers were controlled by the Spirit of God to write the Bible. Understand? So Trinity initiates contact with tongues, just as Yahweh, God, takes the initiative in salvation. No one comes to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. That's what Amashiach said in John 6 and 44. So Yahweh, God, will draw man, must respond. Thomas tries to remove the warning message, the conviction of sin, and the eternal danger is disturbing. It affronts our pride, and we don't want that. We don't want to hear it. Tazadaq told you to become a secure part of credit. We don't want to hear it. Oh, it's made up. It's a fake. So, same thing with the Most High message. You say you want to hear it. You don't want to hear it. You don't want to hear it. See, the lost persons, right? The debtors tries to regain control of their thoughts from the disturbing impulse. Just like Thomas in the Matrix. Thomas hits the control key. And when that fails, he may try the escape key. It is well, Thomas hits the escape key. So that's an interesting triple metaphor, of course, right? Thomas knocks the escape key twice. The computer says, not twice. And then Troy knocks twice on Thomas's door. So for every knock of the escape key, Trinity answers with a written knock back to Thomas, showing God's presence or persistence and knocking on the heart of the lost person, of the debtor, of the strongman. Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to him. Book of Revelation 3, verse 20. So Trinity's prediction of the knocks on Thomas' door parallels the omniscience of Yahweh Almighty. Thomas is a computer hacker who peddles software to Troy. So the film credits lists the character's name as Troy and not Troy, right? So hacking is illegal. And so it's obvious he's bad company in the moral sense. Thomas is a sinful man. Thomas is a law breaker. Thomas is a debtor who has sinful friends, like many of you. Scripture said, come out from amongst them and be you separate. You don't want to separate from your sinful friends. So on a deeper level, here is one of the most fascinating ironies of this movie, The Matrix. Thomas thinks that he's actually hacking into computers, but in truth, the Matrix computers controls Thomas' entire existence, even allowing him the illusion that he's hacking. If that will pass the Bible. So the prison allows some illusionary escape to keep the prisoner, obviously, to the real problem. That's what's going on with you. They give you a stimulus plan to keep you a damn prison. You understand? So to parallel spiritually, the fallen world fools its prisoner with meaningless progress. Well, we're going to get a stimulus plan. We're going to get out of this debt. We're going to overcome this. So like the rich fool in the book of Luke, right? Luke chapter 12, verse 20, who focused on earthly riches but neglected his eternal state. An equally deadly deception occurs when lost people, like many of us, debtors, believe that they are saving themselves by doing good works, making political changes. That's what's going on right now. Hacking away at the evils in the world and themselves. However, Yahweh, God Almighty, declares the nature of our problem is spiritual, and that the only He can remedy it for us through Christ, Hamashiach, the Hamashiach. So in another angle, Thomas' vain attempts to hack the system as a divorced person, but contrasts and foreshadows his fictitious hack of the Matrix once he's now Neo, meaning new. So Thomas puts $2,000 in a hollow copy of a post-minister Gene Bullitt's. So the camera lingers on the chapter title on the nihilism, right? The nihilism means the rejection of all religious and moral principles. The nihilism means that life is meaningless. So Thomas lives in the pinnacle of a simulacrum, right? A simulacrum, which means the image that has no underlying truth. So Thomas Wall and the photo persona that he's actually developed it to be is completely on illusion. The fallen real world is vastly different. So man, being created in the image and likeness of Yah, of God, and placed into a perfect world, severed himself from the creator by rebellion. By rebellion to who? His woman, Eve. And unless man reconciles with the Most High through Christ, a man crafts his own fertile image apart from the truth of God, right? See, an unsaved man is dead, even if he think he wins. The trimming of this worldly life is vain and temporary. It's temporary. It's vain. It's a mask covering his lost spiritual and eternal state. See, we focus on damn tangible things and glory in our civilizations.